room of a London pub at a very traditional event. It's a wedding reception. The speeches have just been made. The drink is flowing freely. The bride and groom are peering into each other's eyes. So yes, it is a very traditional event, but there is a modern twist to it.
So let's have a chat to the bride and groom. Mark, what's been any different from any normal wedding?
The wedding itself was set up as a Facebook event. We set this up and invited everybody on Facebook. Then the promotion to try and get all of our friends to come was on Twitter and Facebook as well. And then if you look on Twitter today, we can see all of our friends talking about it, sharing photographs and stuff from the day.
Angelica, were you dubious about this idea, or is it your idea too?
It was also my idea. My parents, for example, didn't get to make it to the wedding, but they were really closely following what was going on and really feeling like they were taking part of it, and that's all thanks to social media tools.
Mark and Angelica may be an extreme case, but in just a short space of time, the idea of sharing our lives on the internet has become commonplace. From Leeds to Lagos, from Minnesota to Mumbai, hundreds of millions of people now turn to sites like Facebook and Twitter when they want to tell the world about a new baby, a new job, exams passed or failed, news, views, just about everything from the life-changing to the irredeemably trivial. Over the next 3 weeks, I'll be delving into the history of this phenomenon, asking where social networking has come from and where it may be heading next. But let's begin by finding out how we got here. It's a story that starts a lot earlier than you might think. I'm in Berkeley outside quite a shabby-looking restaurant, but 37 years ago, this was the site of Leopold's Records, where something called Community Memory was born. And that has a claim to be the world's first computer-based social network. When I die and I'm able to rest,
gonna go to the place that's the best. When I see a grand set of stairs going up there. We didn't have that. We had a little flight of stairs, possibly this door.
I'm Lee Felsenstein. I was a member of the Community Memory Group that set up the first terminal on the first public access bulletin board system here in 1973.
Community memory was fairly basic. Users would type messages into one of a handful of terminals scattered around Berkeley and the San Francisco Bay Area. Then others could search those messages and post their own. So, a computerized version of paper bulletin boards.
They had a musician's bulletin board at the top of the stairs that led to the record store. So we had our teletype terminal shrouded in a box that I built out of cardboard lined with foam.
So what was the first message typed into that terminal?
I really don't remember the first message. There's no ribbon cutting, there's no grand pronouncement. It just sort of picked up business. We thought that there would be considerable resistance to the idea of computers invading the domain of the counterculture. And we were wrong. People would walk up the stairs, and we had a few seconds in which to tell them, "Would you like to use our electronic bulletin board? We're using a computer." And with the word computer, their eyes would brighten up, and they say, "Oh, wow, can I use it?"
Were people using it to arrange dates?
Almost certainly, yes. I think more likely they were using it to explore their community. Who are the people who are around me?
In the UK, we often put blue plaques up outside historic places. Do you think this place deserves one?
Yes, I do. It might say something like, here in 1973 was opened the first public access computer system for use by people with no familiarity with the technology. The door to cyberspace was opened here for the first time, and it was found to be hospitable territory.
It was a fascinating experiment that survived on and off for a decade without ever reaching more than a tiny audience. But computing technology was changing fast.
Soon, every home could have its own computer. They're already on sale in the high street, shops like this for a few hundred pounds. And it's a rapidly growing market for small businessmen and enthusiasts who can come here to learn how they work.
Shortly one will be able to buy powerful computers, which once upon a time would have cost £1 million, literally. You'll be able to buy these for a matter of pennies.
Until the early 1980s, hardly anyone who wasn't a student or a scientist had been allowed near a computer. Then the personal computer started to take off, and soon people were using them to build bigger online communities. Perhaps the most important was one based in California. It was called The Well.
These are the people from BBC. This is Tina, also known as Onesie, and Stuart Brand, SBB.
But when a camera crew visited a well party in the late 1980s, they didn't know what to make of it.
I come from England. We haven't got the slightest idea what the well is for.
Well, one of its functions is social. It also is a source of information.
Well, it's kind of a cross between a telephone conversation and a letter. It's kind of a strange dynamic. I mean, people can get really intimate online, and then when there's a real face-to-face party like this, people are kind of amazed at who they've been communicating with.
The Well was an online message board filled with topics, everything from trivia to politics to the meaning of life. It gathered together Northern California's hackers, hippies, and journalists, but it had its origins in a crisis in the remote Himalayas.
I'm just tweeting that I'm waiting to meet Dr. Larry Brilliant, who founded The Well in 1985. I'm saying it was Twitter 20 years before Twitter.
Hello, Rory. How are you?
Very well.
My apologies. The other meeting lasted a little longer.
What got you interested in this whole idea of connecting people through computers?
I was lucky. I lived in India for 10 years, and I worked for WHO on the team that eradicated smallpox. And a group of us, we wanted to do it again. So we started an organization called the SAVA Foundation. And our first project was to do a blindness survey in Nepal and find out what are the causes of blindness. And in Nepal, to go visit every place, you've got to have a helicopter. We had all this infrastructure. Steve Jobs, who I had known from India, had given me one of the very early Apples. On the last day of the survey, the helicopter crashed. The pilot was asked what happened, and he said, nothing, just a simple spare parts order, engine one. And so my interest in social networking that led to The Well began with trying to find a replacement engine. Steve had given me a modem, and we networked in, and suddenly we had a donation of a spare engine from Aerospatiale. Pan American offered to fly the engine into Kathmandu, and 72 hours later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.